Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Creative Adventures. If you haven't guessed, we are making cookies today. I got an order for a kid's birthday party for 30 cookies, mixed designs for Lego themed cookies. As usual, I've already got my cookies baked, but I did want to talk a little bit about the shapes I'm using today. You've seen me use plaque cutters before, so I've got a couple of those. Some of these are going to have the kid's name on it, some are going to have his age, and then I've also got some just rectangular cookies and some square cookies, and these are going to be actual Legos, obviously. But then over here, I've got some funky looking shapes. And these are going to be two of the main characters from the Lego movie. I obviously did not have cutters to make these, so I wanted to show you real quick how I did that. I actually hand cut these cookie shapes with a knife, but what I used was just some regular old cardstock, and I drew out my template on that cardstock and then cut it out. So for this one, I just used a round cookie cutter to get the general shape, and then added on the ponytail and the little neck piece right here. And I did kind of draw out her hair just so I have an idea from when I'm decorating these about where the lines are gonna go. And this is my boy one. You probably recognize the character now that you're seeing it kind of drawn out. And he's gonna have his hard hat on. I decided to do it with the hard hat on. So I actually did also make templates for my Legos themselves, just because I knew I wanted them to be a specific ratio, so I measured these out. It is 3 inches by 1.5 inches, and then this is just a 1.5 inch square. So I did actually draw all those out, and I cut all of these by hand, and then these I used my standard plaque cookie cutters for. So let's talk about colors, because there's a whole lot of them for this set. It took me about 1.5 hours to actually mix all my colors up. So first up, we've got primary colors plus green. yellow, red, blue, green. For the yellow, I used about a 4-to-1 ratio of lemon yellow to egg yellow. So that's 4 parts lemon and 1 part yellow. For the red, it's just a whole bunch of super red. For the blue, I used mostly sky blue with just a touch of royal blue. So those are the two colors from AmeriColor, sky blue and royal blue. And then for the green, that's just straight leaf green, which is this one. Also, I have flood consistency for these, and I also have piping consistency for all 4 of these. For the boy's hair, I have just a tiny bit of brown, and this is a 20-second icing. I have black, both piping and flood. I have the tiniest amount of white I've ever made in my life, but that's just gonna be for the smile and for the to put some highlight on the eyes, so it's a very, very tiny amount of 20-second white icing. Finally, I have some fuchsia, which is gonna be for part of her hair. If you remember, she's got actually streaks in her hair of fuchsia and blue, so it's just a very, very small amount of fuchsia, and this is flood consistency. For mixing these colors, the black is obviously just super black, the white is just plain white icing with no color in it. The brown is all chocolate brown from AmeriColor. And then for the fuchsia, AmeriColor makes a fuchsia food coloring. I have some, actually. It is this color. It does not look like this. It looks like a mauve-y purple color, and it's awful. I actually made this color, which is still a little bit more mauve-y than I would like because I don't have an electric color to use. But I made this using deep pink, mostly deep pink, with just a tiny, tiny touch of violet. So every time I've tried to use that fuchsia color from AmeriColor, I've been disappointed. Also a note, you've never seen me use these tiny bottles before, and that's because they are the bane of my existence. I've never hated a decorating tool more than I hate these stupid bottles. Actually, that's really not fair. The thing is I love working with these bottles because they're so much smaller. This is my standard size bottle, so you can see how much smaller it is. They are really, really easy to work with because they fit in my hand really well. The problem is the mouth of these bottles is so small that they are nearly impossible to fill with icing. If your icing stream even thinks about touching the inner edge of this mouth, it will collect and just bubble over. And it takes forever to fill these things. Anybody have suggestions on a nice wide mouth but small bottle like this? hit me up because I could use it. One other thing I may be doing on these cookies. I haven't really decided yet, so we'll figure that out as we go along. But I'm thinking on the plaque cookies, I actually want to do a background on them with an airbrush. I have a pearl sheen color for my airbrush machine that would just basically give the parts that are stenciled a sheen to them. It'd be barely noticeable, but I think it'd be real cute. And I don't even know if you could see this on the camera, but this is like just a confetti pattern. And I thought that that would be really neat on the plaque cookies just to give them a little bit more interest behind the message with his name or his age or whatever. So I still haven't decided yet. We're gonna figure that out as we go along. As usual, I will more than likely be speeding up most of this video just because it would be an incredibly long video if I didn't. So without further ado, let me get my workspace organized and we'll get started. Alright, day two. So this is the progress I made last night. That plus all of these. These are going to be the actual Legos. I'm loving how bright these colors turned out. I may have mentioned before that royal icing a lot of times will darken up a little bit after as it sets. So everything's a little bit darker and brighter than it was in the bag yesterday. So this blue is really pretty. I'm really happy with how that turned out. I don't love how the fuchsia turned out. Color-wise or hue-wise, it's pretty spot on to the actual character. I just wish it was more of like a brighter, like neon kind of color. Just actual color-wise, it is right. So I'll have to order some electric colors from AmeriColor so I can get exactly what I'm wanting in the future, but I'm still very happy with it. I'm also really happy with how cute these little faces turned out. She's gonna get some more details. She'll get some eyebrows, we'll outline the lips and give her some freckles, and then just kind of add some overpiping to the hair just to give it a little bit more dimension. I'm gonna do the outlining probably with a food color marker and the freckles, so that's gonna be really cute. These guys are obviously not completely flooded. It just got late last night and I didn't want to wait for this part to dry so that I could do the hair and the neck. So I'm going to do those first so that they have time to dry while I'm working on the rest of the details. And then I'll come back in and add his eyebrows. And does he have eyebrows? I can't remember. Yeah, he has eyebrows. And then outline his mouth, and we'll put some piping on his little hat too, his hard hat. All of these are the ones I think I'm going to airbrush. I'm going to do one shape first and make sure I like it. I really hope it turns out the way I want, because I don't have any extra cookies this time, so I can't make any mistakes. So we're gonna hope it turns out the way I want, otherwise I'm screwed. Let's go ahead and just get started. Put my Sopranos on. Y'all, last night, the episode of Sopranos that I watched was the saddest episode ever. Like, I never watched the Sopranos when it was on its original run, and so this is my first time ever watching them. And I'm on the season 5 episode where, let's just say, it was Adriana's last episode, and oh my god, it was just so sad. She was one of my favorite characters. She was annoying. Like, she's an annoying character, but I just felt so much for her. And I just felt so bad for her. And I liked her. I just liked her character, man. And that was just depressing. Anyway, moving on. Alright, I've moved some of my cookies out of the way because these are the ones I'm going to try to airbrush. I want to show you what this is. This is a stencil holder. It's just a 3D printed stencil holder. I can't remember who I bought this from though. I'll have to see if I can find it and link that in my blog post and down below. But you can buy these stencil sheets. They're just acetate. You could probably make these with a Cricut or some kind of a digital cutter like that, or Silhouette or whatever. But they're just acetate sheets of a stencil, and then you sandwich it in between these two pieces, just like that. Now you'll notice that these are like two different widths, so this bottom piece is a little bit taller than this top piece, and that's so you can set it down on top of your cookie and put it on whatever side actually fits your cookie the best. So if you do smaller, if you roll your cookie dough out thinner, then you'll use it on the short side, and if you roll your cookie dough out thicker, like I do, because I roll mine at about a quarter inch, you can roll it out, or you can flip it onto the tall side, and it fits just against your cookie, just perfectly. So then you just take your airbrush and then airbrush over the stencil, and it makes it super easy because then, you know, this holds the stencil in place, so you're not getting your fingers in the way. And it's heavy enough that it won't move around either from the pressure of the airbrush. So then you can just, you know, move your cookie out of the way when you're done, put your next one on, and it makes the process really, really quick. So I have also used just regular cardstock. I did a set of cookies that were like a graffiti style, and I cut my stencils out of cardstock using my Cricut, and then just cut them to the square, to the size of this holder, and I used it the exact same way. So yeah, you don't have to buy your stencils if you want to make them yourself. Totally easy to do that. So let me get my airbrush machine out, and I'm probably gonna try this on like a piece of cardstock first, just to see what it looks like on top of color, and we may or may not be doing this on the cookies. We'll see. guys. It's day three. Our cookies are dry. This is the final set, and I am really, really happy with how these turned out. So first and foremost, we have our plaque cookies with the kid's name on it. And I did go ahead and airbrush them. It's a very subtle background, a very subtle confetti background. I used the Pearl Sheen AmeriColor airbrush color, and it really did exactly what I was hoping. It's just a very, very subtle background on these cookies to give them a little bit of interest. I really need to use my airbrush a little more because it really adds a lot of depth to cookies, and it's fun to use too. So we have those in all of the colors, and I did the same treatment to the cookies with his age on it, and it's still, again, that very subtle confetti background color. So that's what those look like. And then we have our, well, we have our Lego cookies here. I guess I don't really need to show you those, but yeah. What I'm thinking about with these is, so she ordered 30 cookies, and actually, if you count them, I have more than 30 because I thought it would be cute to bag these up two in each bag. So this would be the same as like one cookie, just because these are a little bit smaller, obviously, than our other cookies in the set. So I thought I would do a rectangular one and a square one together in each bag, one of differing colors. So that's the plan there. And then we have our Lego Man cookies. Look how cute these guys are. I think these are so cute. They turned out exactly as I was envisioning, which makes me really happy. And my favorites, which are, I can't remember her name, but like seriously, are these not the cutest cookies you've ever seen? These are definitely my favorite of the bunch. She's just adorable. Adorable. All right, so now I am going to get these packaged up. Let me get my cookies moved out of the way, and then I'll show you what I use to package all of my cookies if they need to be packaged individually. So for orders that are being delivered or picked up locally, packaging is kind of a two-step process for me. I always ask my customers if they actually want their cookies to be individually packaged for like favors or that sort of thing, or if they just want them loose in a box, because sometimes they don't want them to be packaged individually. In this case, we are packaging them all separate. So for that, I use polypropylene bags that are just like this. Sometimes you'll see them labeled as treat bags or something of that nature. There's a Wilton line of these that you can buy at Michael's or Hobby Lobby or AC Moore. They're kind of expensive if you're going to be using a lot of them, and you also only get at max 100 in a bag. So if you're not doing this very often, that's perfectly reasonable, and that's actually what I used to do. I would just go to Michael's and buy a 100 bag pack. The ones you buy from the hobby store also come with standard silver twist ties. And again, for a long time, that's exactly what I did. I would just twist tie the tops of those bags closed and call it a day. As I have started to sell more and more cookies, I wanted something that was a little faster to close up, and I wanted something that would seal in freshness a little better than a twist tie. And I wanted to start buying more than just 100 of those dang bags at a time. It was also really problematic if I needed them on short notice and Michael's was out of them. So I have actually started ordering mine online. The place I've been ordering a lot of this kind of stuff from is webstaurantstore.com. So restaurant, but web at the beginning, so Webstaurant Store. It's kind of a wholesale place, and they do have good prices. So the more that you buy, the bigger bulk that you buy, the better price you get. And I order these in a box of 2,000 now. So I order big boxes of them now. And I also finally invested in an impulse sealer. This thing is great because it was actually really inexpensive. I think I got this one on eBay for like 20 bucks. And it's on right now. It's on and plugged in. It only gets hot when you actually close the top, when you actually press it down on it. So it will work for a couple of different kinds of materials, but polypropylene is one of those materials that it will work with. It will also work with shrink wrap, so like PVC shrink wrap bands or bags, it will work with that too. So yeah, you could even shrink wrap your cookies if you want to. I'm not going to be doing that. I do have shrink wrap bags for my soaps and stuff, but I don't typically do that for my cookies. So this thing is super easy to use. I have a backpack already open here. So it's just individual little clear polypropylene bags, and you're just going to slide your cookie right inside. There's a knob on the end with heat settings. It's actually not heat settings, it's time settings. And I've already got mine set right where I need it. But when you press down on this, it's going to engage that heater, and the light will go off when it's ready for you to release. So you want to hold it down until the light goes off, and then it's ready to release. So I've got my bag right where I want it to seal in the middle of this Teflon band here. And just press down. I'm going to press down pretty hard. Lift up. And that one did not seal very well. Well, it did. It just kind of pulled the bag off. But there, you can see it's completely sealed now. It has completely sealed that cookie in. And sometimes these bags are not always going to fit your cookies just right. So sometimes I do like to go and just like seal the other side so that it makes the bag a little bit smaller and makes it just fit kind of perfect. So there. And then what you would do is just trim that edge. So there it is, all trimmed and sealed. And now it's the perfect size for my cookie. I just think that this makes a much nicer presentation than just twist tying the top of it closed. Now I will say, for like some special orders, I have gone to the trouble of going and finding ribbon that matches my design and tying the tops of my bags up with ribbon. Now if you're gonna do that, I think that is actually nicer than doing this. But for just like standard orders that aren't looking for anything special packaging wise, they just want them to be individually packaged, I think this is great because it's making sure that your cookie stays nice and fresh in the packaging, and it just looks a lot cleaner and more professional. So let me get the rest of these cookies packaged up and then we'll get them boxed up and they'll be ready to go. All right, now that we've got all of our cookies individually wrapped in this polypropylene bag and sealed up, now we just need to box them up and they're ready to go. So I buy a variety of different boxes. I usually try to find whatever deal is good online at the time. Sometimes I order from Amazon, but a lot of times I also order my boxes from that Webstaurant store. I buy a variety of shapes and sizes because I also do cakes and cupcakes. So I have standard bakery boxes that are just like the white 4 to 5 inch high boxes. If I'm doing a whole lot of cookies, like several dozen, I will sometimes package them up in a bigger like cupcake size box. But these are actually my favorite boxes for cookies that are going to be picked up from me because, I don't know, I just like how they look. I think they have a nice design. These are actually pie boxes. They're meant for those disposable, you know, the disposable aluminum pies. They fit those pie tins perfectly. So that's actually why I bought these originally, but realized that they work really well for cookies. So just a standard little box here, and the lid comes down over the top. I'll probably need to use 2 of these. Lid comes down, you've got the window on top, and it looks real nice. So these are, what, 2 inches high, so it's a 2-inch high box. So I'll just pop a variety of cookies in each. Now, and also, if I am doing my cookies loose, if they are not packaged, I will usually pack the bottom of the box with tissue paper or something like that. In fact, I might go ahead and do that now anyway. Let me grab some tissue paper. Kind of fold it up and kind of messily put it in the bottom. It just looks a little nicer with some tissue paper in there. Okay, there's one box down. Look how cute that looks packaged up. And last but not least, I need to label these. So I operate under Virginia's cottage food laws, which allows me to run a bakery out of my home without having an inspection by the Department of Agriculture. There are some rules with working under a cottage food law, and I will go ahead and say, not every state has cottage food laws. And every state's cottage food laws are different. So if you're not in Virginia, I would highly recommend you look at what your own state's laws are before you try to open a home-based bakery like this. Some of my limitations are I can't sell to the public anything that needs to be refrigerated. So I have a limited set of like icings I can make. Like I can't sell tres leches cakes or things like that because I can't do anything that needs refrigeration. Additionally, most states have limits on the amount of money that you can make as profit from running a home-based bakery business. Virginia actually has some pretty lenient laws and we don't have limits on baked goods. Profit-wise, I can't sell my goods online. My sales have to be person-to-person, and I can't sell across state lines. Yes, you do sometimes see me packaging goods up for shipping, but that's actually just to friends and family. I can't sell my goods to somebody in another state and ship them. So another thing that I have to do is label all of my goods. Everything I sell has to have this label on it that shows what the item is. I have to have a statement on there that says not for resale, processed and prepared without state inspection. The thing I've got my finger on is my business name and my address and the date that it was produced, and these cookies were actually made on the 10th, so that's the date that I put on there, and then my ingredient list. One thing I am exempted from is actually providing a nutritional label because of the size of my business, but you can look under FDA rules and regulations to find all that information. Just be sure and check your state laws, make sure you have cottage food laws in your state, and make sure you're abiding by them. So, I have these printed off on, they're just label paper like you can get at Office Depot or Staples. Again, I order pretty big packs of it because I use it for lots of stuff, not just these kinds of labels. So I'm actually going to put this on the front of the box. And last but not least, I also use my this label paper to make little logos to just put a sticker on the top of the box. So it's my logo, and I use my Cricut to cut them out, and I just have sheets of these laying around so I can very easily just like pop them off and put them on the top corner of the box. So here's our finished product. Here's our boxed cookies, and got my little logo label on the top, and got my ingredient label, and all of the other information that I have to print under the cottage food law there on the front. And these two are ready to go out the door. So I hope you have enjoyed watching me make these cookies and watching how I package them up. If you have comments or questions or suggestions for future videos, let me know in the comments below. Check out my blog at rachelscreativeadventures.com, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.